to all the learners. Today in the CEC lecture, we will be looking at globalization. Now, to understand globalization, we'll be now taking use of various theories that explain globalization. Once again, welcome everyone. And now as we take our learning forward, once we are trying to understand globalization, we have to begin from where, that is the starting point, that what is globalization? Globalization signifies integration, exchange, which can be depicted with movement of goods and services from one part of the globe to other. The idea of globalization is nothing new. It has existed in the past also. However, the contemporary form of neoliberal driven globalization is so rampant that today it has become an very unprecedented phenomena for nations in the global affairs at political, economic, technological, cultural, ecological dimensions, amongst others. Now, once we try to understand globalization for a comprehensive perspective, we have certain theories, and these theories give us an insight as to what are the nuances involved in globalization also. So, one process of globalization, one concept of globalization is looked at from different perspective, different approaches, which therefore bring forward nuanced understanding of globalization. At the very outset, let's understand the liberal theory towards globalization. See, liberalism stands for liberty of the individual. Globalization as a market extension of modernization, developments in technology, technological advances, and at the same time with suitable legal and institutional arrangement to enable markets and liberal democracy to spread on a trans-world scale. So, therefore, globalization with this aspect is seen as a very positive development for human freedom, for human society at large, with technical standardization, administrative harmonization, which therefore liberals definitely see globalization in a very positive outcome. Now, whenever we try to understand global relations, one of the theories that is always primary to understanding international relations is the realist theory. There have been various scholars in the realist theories. There have been various streams of realism also, as seen in realism to neorealism to the debate between offensive realist and defensive realist. However, certain common aspects in all schools of realism is statism leading to survival, paving way for self-help. The realists give primacy to state power, pursuit of national interest, conflict between states. Now, in this idea, when we try to get the understanding of globalization, so therefore the idea comes forward that is of a hegemon state. That is, now when states are competing for markets, when states are competing with each other for profit, therefore, in this strategy, in the contest of power between several major states in contemporary world politics. So, when we look at globalization from the realist discourse, the idea of struggle for profits or competition or markets is seen as an inherent tendency of the international relations system, wherein state is the rational actor and the pursuit of national interest is given ultimate supremacy. In this aspect, the quest for power is seen as rational for the existence of a state. So therefore, for realists, even states are competing for power, for profits and markets in the global arena, it is therefore an extension of the operation of the state power. It is justified for the pursuit of national interest, and the conflict between state is one of the defining features of global politics also. Now, when we try to look at international relations, another perspective that comes forward is the Marxist perspective. Now, we all know that Marxism stands for the idea that there is a dichotomy between the haves and the haves not. And a deeper understanding of this schism, of this dichotomy, comes when we try to understand the base superstructure model. Now, to this base superstructure model, which has been explained to us by Karl Marx draws from Hegel's dialectic idealism. Karl Marx inverts Hegelian dialectics in the form of dialectical materialism, wherein not the ideas but matter is the moving force of history. Marx looks at various phases of history wherein there is division of the society between the haves and the haves not, and this division of the society is primarily based on the foundation of the base of economic forces, which gets translated into social relations, political apparatus, cultural milieu, amongst others. In the Greek time, society was divided into freemen and slaves. In the Roman time, the society was divided into patricians and plebeians. In the feudal time, the society was divided into vassals versus serfs. In the Industrial Revolution time, the society was divided as factorymen versus factory workers. And in the capitalist time, the society is divided into bourgeois versus proletariat. And one of the defining criteria of this division of social classes is means of ownership of production. Who owns the means of production? Now, taking a cue from this Marxist ideas, when we try to interpolate it with the globalization syndrome, social exploitation through unjust distribution is one of the focus of the Marxist perspective. And this too, for understanding globalization, therefore they look at how trans-world connectivity, which is of course seen as being related to globalization, how globalization is seen as integration, interchange and exchange, how this trans-world connectivity enhances of profit-making and surplus accumulation. But however, this is an outcome of a historically specific capitalist development. As to quote Lenin, that imperialism is the highest stage of capitalism. So, and taking this Marxist perspective only forward, the neo-Marxists in the work of dependency and world system theories, they examine how capitalist accumulation on a global scale with core and peripheral countries. So therefore, the development of the core happens at the cost of underdevelopment of the periphery, because of the cycle going wherein resources of the periphery are used for the development of the core. And therefore, the idea that is, you know, the world is, if I we take the work of American sociologist Immanuel Wallerstein for an insight into global affairs, we can of course get in globalization also here, that state is one of the rational actors in international relations, but at the same time the capitalist world system is highly unjust, because it leads to development of the core at the expense of underdevelopment of periphery. Globalization in this light, therefore, the Marxists and neo-Marxists question whether why is it that capital is more mobile and labor is not? If we are witnessing to rise of multinational corporation, at what cost it comes? Does it come at the expense of huge impact on the working and the labor population? Then at the same time, if this rise of market, a global market phenomena, does this lead to reduction of social service welfare nets? So all these questions present a contested realm wherein via the Marxist and the neo-Marxist perspective, globalization is seen from the lens of capitalist exploitation. Globalization is seen from this end result also, namely unjust distribution between the rich and the poor at the individual as well as at the state level for the quest of profit making and surplus accumulation. Then we try to look at globalization, another perspective that comes forward is that of constructivism. When we look at constructivism, it, you know, fields of anthropology, humanities, media studies, sociology, all have an impact on the ideas that go in the theory of constructivism. Social actors, constructivism argues, construct their world. So therefore, when we are trying to look at globalization, constructivism throws light on the conversation, symbolic exchanges, intersubjective construction and communication of shared as well as self-understanding. Another theory that is very important to give us another alternative and critical perspective on understanding globalization is that of postmodernism. Herein the work of Michel Foucault, wherein the focus here is understanding society is seen as an equivalent of understanding the knowledge power structure, whereby it is said that knowledge is power because power structures shape knowledge. Now, postmodernism has also been seen as incredulity towards meta-narrative. So, in this line, it is said that, you know, when we try to understand globalization, one should throw light on the power games, seen from the perspective of the knowledge power system. Now, when we are trying to look at globalization and it's a societal phenomena and process, the feminist perspective gives us another alternative insight into the operation of globalization. See, feminism stands for social construction, wherein masculinity and femininity are seen. Feminism argues that the distinction between a man and a woman, they are biological differences. However, when biological differences are made to be seen in terms of discrimination, in terms of privileging one over the other, namely a male being preferred over a female, using the social construct of gender. Feminism's main light is on understanding the factors that lead to discrimination for women. What is it that there is structural subordination to men, looking at globality of women issues and the social order. So in this light, when we try to understand globalization, feminist studies have also drawn light at how with globalization, the idea of patriarchal domination did continue, because even today at several world forums and at for several multinational corporations, there is lack of women workforce. At the same time, very few women make it to the power ladder or to the top positions of hierarchy in several international organizations. This leads to feminists to question the basis of thinking of these forces of integration and exchange, wherein feminism, therefore, while understanding globalization, points towards social construction of masculinity and femininity, looking at status of women from the perspective of women in workforce, from the perspective of women at the topper levels of hierarchy in international organization, looking at women concerns in areas of globality and social order, amongst others. Now, there's another alternative perspective that comes forward as we try to understand globalization, is that of transformationalism. This theory has been explained by David Held and several colleagues. Globalization is increased interconnectedness in political, economic, and cultural matters across the world, creating a, what we can say, shared social space. Given this interconnectedness, it is argued globalization may be defined as a process. Globalization may be defined, if we go by the work of Held and others, a process or set of processes which embodies a transformation in the spatial organization of social relations and transactions, and expressed in transcontinental or inter-regional flows and networks of activity, interaction, power. Now, to understand more on these ideas, this very important work that we will can use for further reference, that is Held and McGrew's analytical framework. This presents to us three-part typology for theories of globalization. Let's take them one by one from the work of Held and McGrew. First is the hyperglobalists. They are contemporary, they define contemporary globalization as a new era in which people everywhere are increasingly subject to the disciplines of global marketplace. The next one is a skeptic. The skeptic, for example, Hurst and Thompson have been put in this category, ostensibly argue that globalization is a myth which conceals the reality of an international economy increasingly segmented into three major regional blocks in which national governments remain very powerful. Then is transformationalist. Transformationalists argue that globalization occurs as states and societies across the globe are experiencing a process of profound change as they try to adapt to a more interconnected but highly uncertain world order. So, therefore, when we try to look at the idea, the process of globalization, we see that multiple approaches give us insights into different aspects of globalization. Today, the world is witnessing events wherein there is questioning of globalization. For example, the liberals, if they say that globalization has proved beneficial for human society in terms of market-led extension of modernization, technological advances, suitable legal institutional arrangement, then at the same time there is a critique that technology, does it have accessibility for all? Then at the same time there is a debate that whether international trade led to a more unequal world, and at the same time today there is a call for rolling back of globalization by certain world leaders, looking at how the fallout of globalization was on the indigenous native people. If the realists perceive globalization as an extension of state power games wherein pursuit of national interest is ultimately sacred, then at the same time today there is a question that today should states therefore then adopt more protectionist measures in order to cope up or to react to the rising world competition in international trade and other realms. And therefore, there is again a debate here between protectionism, with economic nationalism, and the other idea of liberalism. So therefore, in this contested realm, the ideas which are there within the realm of globalization are existing. If at one point we are saying that globalization has led to space-time compression, globalization has led to idea that therein there is a retreat of the state and rise of market to offer more opportunities for the people, then at the same time today there are new forms of technological dimension. Then the other Marxist perspective gives to us an another insight into global processes, that this trans world connectivity, opportunities of profit making, surplus accumulation, has it led to more unjust distribution? Has it led to development of few over underdevelopment of many? Then another insight that comes forward, which the constructivists have presented to us, that is, it's the social actors that construct the world, and therefore for understanding globalization, one must look at intersubjective construction, communication, exchange amongst others. Most important, as we take the journey in understanding globalization, how power within the global systems of integration and exchange are linked to knowledge. This insight has been given to us in the postmodern perspective. And another insight, as we take our learning in globalization forward, has been given to us by the feminist discourse, wherein within the web of integration and exchange, one looks at the idea that does masculinity and femininity, is this idea at work when we see structural subordination of women to men, when we see discrimination of women at several social, economic, political level only because of the biological differences between man and women. And then amidst all this, we see that the debate wherein one sees that globalization is increased interconnected in political, economic and cultural matters, and at the same time processes, other definition that gives us, that embodies a transformation in the spatial organization of social relations and transactions. So therefore, therein there is another three-part typology that we just saw in hyperglobalist, skeptist and transformationalist. So while we try to understand globalization, we see that it is a contested realm. No doubt, world has witnessed a history of space-time compression. However, at the same time, today there are clarion calls at various international news and events, wherein there is a call for rollback of globalization, the deglobalization syndrome, in terms of diminishing interdependence and integration, is seen at several international news too. And this gives a call that is the world apparatus, the thinking that goes in the larger global relations apparatus, is it ready for a new script where we'll see reversal of the globalization process, reversal of the process of what we say of integration and exchange. At the same time, there is another perspective, that is today there is a call for reform of globalization. That is, the idea to exist in isolation does not look rational. So in order to enjoy benefits of growth together, today there is a call of reforming globalization, giving globalization a human perspective with the idea of re-globalization. So while we try to understand globalization alongside understanding the dimensions that are involved in terms of the impact of various processes of globalization, one must also look at the debates that tell us that how globalization is a contested realm. So dear Viewers, dear learners, today while we were trying to understand globalization, we are now, as we come towards the conclusion of the lecture, we look forward to suggestions and feedback from you all. We hope you all enjoyed our lecture today. We have presented to you lots of references. Do use them in order to develop your understanding of globalization further. Once we are trying to look at globalization, do keep in mind that globalization is a multidisciplinary subject. In order to comprehend globalization, one needs therefore a multidisciplinary perspective. One needs to understand political dynamics while we are trying to understand the state market discourse. One also needs to have understanding of the forces of economic apparatus while we are trying to understand what is it that leads to more trade, interchange and exchange. One also must look at new dynamics involved in the technological innovations, wherein one we are seeing that technology and data are coming up as new currencies of power. And all this goes to tell us that how globalization is an ambiguous yet very important aspect. There is a debate of rollback of globalization. At the same time, there is another debate of letting globalization work. So we hope you all enjoyed this lecture of understanding globalization. Once again, we look forward to your positive feedback, reviews, and your questions also. We look forward to let you learning more with CEC Live Lectures.